evening, everyone. My name is Tomé Boston Rich. I am the director of the Center for Ignatian Spirituality here at BC, and it's a pleasure to welcome you tonight to this panel discussion on the Society of Jesus General Congregation 36 that just took place in Rome from October the 2nd to November 12th. I am sure that you, like me, are eager to know more about those sessions, the participants, and the future goals of the Society of Jesus. For that, I would like to introduce you to the panelists and the moderators of this session. Father Joe Costantino, he was delegate for the General Congregation from the Northeast Province. Before coming to Boston, he served as president of Canisius High School in Buffalo, New York, pastor of the Church of St. Francis Xavier in Manhattan, director of vocations in the New York and Maryland provinces, and as executive director of the St. Ignatius Retreat House in New York. He's now the pastor of St. Ignatius of Loyola Church here at Chestnut Hill. Father Jim Gartland, he was a delegate for the General Congregation from the Chicago-Detroit province. Before coming to Boston, he served as president of Christopher Ray Jesuit High School in Chicago. He is now the rector of St. Peter Faber Jesuit Community at Boston College and serves on the board of trustees of Marquette University in New York. Father Tom Stegman, he was a delegate for the General Congregation from the Wisconsin province. He's currently chair of the ecclesiastical faculty and an associate professor of New Testament at Boston College, School of Theology and Ministry. He has served as trustee at St. Joseph University and as co-chair of the Pauline Study Group for the Catholic Biblical Association. And our moderators are Peter Folan. He's a Jesuit priest and a doctoral candidate in systematic theology in the Margery College of Arts and Science here at Boston College. He was born and raised on Long Island. He has studied as a Jesuit at Fordham University and Boston College, and he has worked at St. Joseph University in Philadelphia, the University of Scranton, St. Ignatius of Loyola Parish here in Chestnut Hill, and Holy Trinity Catholic Church in Washington, D.C. Finally, Margery Eagan, as probably many of you know, she is the co-host of WGBH midday program Boston Public Radio, along with co-host Kimberly. Margery grew up in Fall River. She attended Smith College and graduated from Stanford University. In 2015, she won first place for excellence in religion commentary at the Religion News Writers Association annual conference in Philadelphia. She's a parishioner of St. Ignatius Church and very much involved in Ignatian spirituality. So thank you all for being here tonight. But before starting our conversation, let me surprise you with greetings from a very important person who also wanted to be present tonight on this panel, Father Arturo Sosa, the newly elected superior of the Society of Jesus.
I'm happy to be able to bring the men and women to have come together at Boston College to discuss the General Congregation with three of its members, Joe Costantino, Jim Gallen, and Tom Stegman. Jesuits from all over the world spent 6 weeks in Rome in prayerful deliberation. Now the conversation continues back where it began, in the provinces and regions of the society. If asked to underline just four key words from our discussions, I might choose this: audacity, discernment, collaboration, and planning. Today, we dare to discern and to respond to the impulse of the Holy Spirit in the Church, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ with joy and hope, to be ministers of reconciliation in a world that is dangerously divided, to live as friends in the Lord, brought together by the mercy of God. Of course, much more could be said, and it was said much more. At what point Pope Francis asked the congregation to see the world not as a sphere, but as a polyhedron, a single structure with different faces corresponding to different contexts and cultures. With that in mind, let me offer two possible comments that might be relevant to your discussion in Boston. First, the intellectual apostolate is quite strong at Boston College and throughout the network of Jesuit universities. But intellectual work is not only for the universities. Universities must do. It's not automatically to do it, but must do intellectual apostolate, intellectual approach to this world. All Jesuits' work should have an intellectual dimension. All should be marked by rigorous analysis and dialogue with rapidly changing cultures. In particular, we need to reflect deeply on the displacement, disorientation, and distress experienced by people at the margins, people whom Pope Francis described as thrown away by our societies. Second, our little society of Jesus, our minima compagnia, needs to grow in collaboration. Jesuits need to collaborate better with each other as well as with their colleagues. Moreover, respecting their legitimate autonomy, the many works associated with the society should understand that they will serve a single mission, a mission carefully discerned and giving concrete expression in an apostolic plan with ongoing assessment and evaluation. Audacity, discernment, collaboration, planning. One could add many other keywords and phrases, evocative image and helpful prayers to guide us together along the way. But I leave to you to your own discussion. Let me close with a word of thanks to you, faculty, staff, and students of Boston College, whose work on the heights of Chestnut Hills bears great fruit around the world. Thank you and good morning.
Well, I guess the intellectual apostle is very strong here at the Heights on Chestnut Hill. That's very good to know. Before we start, when Tamayo asked me to be here tonight, I said I asked him nothing about how Jesuits work, what this whole congregation means. And so I'm assuming that I can't be the only clueless person that's here tonight. So we're going to try to do it in both ways. A lot of you know a lot about this. I don't. I'm assuming some of you don't either. So I thought we'd start out tonight by asking kind of a clueless question, assuming there are some students here. Are there any students here tonight? Okay, so there's some students here. I'm a parishioner at St. Ignatius. There's some from my fellow parishioners are here tonight, and there's some Jesuits here tonight I recognize too. So I guess where I'd like to start is for those of us who don't really understand, what is this whole congregation and the choosing of the new Father General, what does this mean for the people here tonight at Boston College, the students, the people in the pews, and the Jesuits here? What's the significance of it? And step in any of you guys that want to start out.
I think the pastor of St. Ignatius should start. We're in your ecclesial territory.
What's the importance of the thanks time? The importance of a general congregation. basically, they're called usually to elect the general superior of the Society of Jesus. And since the Jesuit general is elected for life, we don't have many of them. Since our founding, we've only had 36, and not all of them have been to elect a general. A general congregation can be called for two reasons. One, to elect a new general superior, but also at different times when the general calls a congregation together. So a famous, famous congregation was GC32. Father Pedro Arrupe, many of you might have heard of him before, he was elected general in GC31. But he called GC32 why? He was elected in 1965. In 1975, he calls this because Vatican II happened. So we have to kind of renew ourselves. And then another general congregation that was called by Father Kolbenbach, who just recently died last month, and Father Arturo went to Beirut, Lebanon for his funeral mass. He called the general congregation together because canon law changed in the church. And so we had to bring our law into line with that. Our congregations are meant for us as Jesuits to talk to ourselves about our mission, following the lead of the church. The church speaks, the Vatican speaks for the entire church. The Society of Jesus doesn't. Although the documents are public there, and people gain much fruit from that, all our collaborators, all the people who work with us, because we're a worldwide organization, but still, the focus is for us. So we wrote even a letter during the congregation, and it's written to Jesuits. Of course, it also includes the colleagues, but it was written mostly for Jesuits in conflict and war-torn situations, and we wanted to support them in all ways.
This is why we wanted to start with you. Your question, I think, we'll be touching upon probably all evening, but just as an entree, what's the impact for us? I think that's why a lot of you are here. I think congregations, in addition to the meetings that, or the explanation that Joe gave, I think it's a natural time to renew ourselves and to reflect very explicitly on things that are always in the back of our minds. So I think there's always a natural kind of launching pad that a congregation can give. And Father Sosa gave all of us some of the words that I think are most probably interesting and relevant for you. His opening homily, one of the key themes was collaboration. And he called Jesuits to be better co-laborers with one another, but also that the mission is such that we need to become better collaborators. We can do pretty well in a place like this, but we can do better. Discernment is a word that you're going to hear over and over, and it's an easy word to name. It's to be an easy word to describe. It's a hard word to put into practice, but in effect, what he's calling, what the congregation is certainly calling Jesuits to, when the documents come out, you see all of us are called to greater sense of being committed to God's presence in our lives in the here and now, in our particular circumstances, and how we're being invited to respond to the mission. And ultimately, and I think this is true for Jesuits, but hopefully when the documents come out, I think the congregation was really calling us to going deeper into our own spirituality and renewing in that sense. So a little bit, this is a sports comparison, but it's a little bit like spring training or training camp. We were called to go to the basics, the things that you do your whole life, but deepening our faith, deepening our sense of how much God loves us through his son Jesus, and that grace at the end of the first week, in light of such great love, how do we respond? So, this would be some general entrees.
Yeah, I think it's for me, it's kind of remarkable that we've only had 31 generals in 476 years. So it's a significant moment for us, but it's also significant, I think, for all of us that it's the first non-European general, too. So now we have the Holy Father from Argentina and Father Sosa from Venezuela, and I think that caught people maybe by surprise a bit.
Us too.
Yeah. And also, I think, you know, there had been a protocol for Jesuits at the congregation to go to the Vatican and have a protocol visit with the Holy Father. But when he was elected, Father Sosa went alone to meet the Holy Father. Actually, when we elected, they called the Holy Father from the Yalu. We were all there, and there's this conversation. They have a new general, and so this is going on in the Yalu. It's kind of funny. But he came back, and he says, the Pope doesn't want us to, he doesn't want a protocol visit. He wants to be part of the general congregation, so he would like to come and spend an entire morning with us. And I think we were all stunned by that, and he basically really did give us a specific mission, I think, and which is tied to, I think, what Tom was saying, going back to our roots. But the word audacity, I gotta look it up. This is a pretty big word for me, if it wasn't me. Because that was used by both the head of the Dominicans in the opening mass, that it is our charism to be audacious, from Ignatius and the First Companions. When Father General was elected in the Mass of Thanksgiving, he used audacity again. And when the Pope came to visit, he used the word audacity to be daring, brave, courageous, really to go to the peripheries. And the two things that we were reminded, we need to be audacious, but we also need to keep vibrant the intellectual life of the church. And popes have, the new pope reiterated that. That is something specifically we need from the Society of Jesus, is a vibrant intellectual life for the church.
Tom, you used a sports analogy. I might use a musical analogy for what you guys just provided. It's like an overture to an opera of many of the things that I think we're hoping to speak about tonight. And one of the things that Father General said that really jumped out to me was, so the conversation continues where it first began. And I was looking up today that tomorrow is actually the two-year anniversary of when this general congregation was formally convoked, December 8th, 2014. And your first meeting in Rome was on October 3rd, 2016, so nearly 2 years. So maybe just a couple questions of what have things been up to for the last 2 years? And maybe specifically how you guys got chosen for this congregation, because I think the statistics came out the other day, we're about 17,000 or so in the world Jesuits, and there were 215 members of the congregation. I know of so many of your virtues from each of you. So how were you among the 215?
I'll start and guys go. So Peter's right, the congregation was called 2 years ago, so that set in motion each of the Jesuit provinces. The Society of Jesus is arranged by provinces. And each of the provinces was called to have a congregation, kind of a miniature of the general congregation. And the way that that gets formed is that the members of the province vote for people to participate in that congregation. And so each of the three of us were voted to participate in our respective province congregation. Now, along with that, each of the provinces was charged with reflecting upon an exercise, the spiritual exercise is the call of the king, and to reflect upon what do we think as individuals going into these congregations and the congregation itself, what do we think are the three most pressing calls today that Christ is inviting us for mission. So that was a lot of our conversation at the congregation itself, and this generated then a whole list that went to the people, coordinating committee of the general congregation. But at the province congregations, depending on the size of the province, the provincial, the one who's in charge, would go ex officio, and then depending on the size of the province, one, two, or three delegates were elected. So in my province, I was the one elected, I think, two
and
two. And three from
four.
Four. Big province. Yeah. So I don't know if either one of you want to pick up.
I think it's slim pickings is the reason that I got chosen.
Everybody else stepped backwards.
You know, it's kind of maybe an antiquated process, but it works. Both, so the Murmurasu, the election of the new general, you know, we basically come at early in the morning and we have an exhortation, then we pray 215 people together, silence for an hour. And then you just start talking to people. So you go to someone you know from Africa, you say, hey, what are you hearing from the continent of Africa? And in the course of the 4 days, these candidates surface, but there's, what happens then is you start talking to the names being mentioned and they're saying, oh, these are my limitations. This is why I don't think I should be. There's no campaigning, there's no politicizing. It's really a process of trying to follow the spirit as to which name is surfacing. And it's going to be someone who's humble and it's not Jesus Christ. And it worked. And I think in terms, I don't know why we were elected, to be honest with you. I think, you know, perhaps because of being a rector of 80 Jesuits from around the world, perhaps being bilingual and working most of my life with immigrants in Chicago and living in Peru for 3 years, perhaps people saw that I had a certain vision that was maybe wider than others. I don't know.
It's just a one-shot deal. You've had your chance. You're out now.
In my case, that will probably be the case. But there were, I don't know the percentage, but there were people in the congregation who had been to the 35th and the 34th.
Including Father General himself, I think, had been at a number.
And the Pope had been, Pope Francis had been at two congregations.
Oh, okay. So you've been more than once. And I, you know, we're going to show a little video, I think, of the Murmurasio in a second.
Sure.
But Murmurasio to me sounds very kind of gossipy, you know, you're kind of talking about it. I wonder, you know, I mean, you're all priests, and this is, you have to think about the good qualities of people. But I just wonder, can you be frank if there's somebody that's, you know, sort of a pain in the neck, and people kind of quietly say, well, Father so-and-so is, you know, bad administrator or kind of a jerk or something. Could people be frank like that, or is it?
Absolutely.
Really? Do you have good stories?
And we have a whole history of being frank. We write, when people are moved through the course, we have a what's known as informationes. And these informationes are such that, so I would write about Tom, for instance, and I would be honest. Should he get four vows? Should he move to priesthood? Should he move to first vows? So all through his life, we have this dossier of informatio. And people are very brutally honest. Brutally.
But not uncharitably.
But it does say, and it was interesting for me, I don't know Tom and Jim's experience, but my experience was that it depended upon the culture. When you ask questions about, let's say, well, what do you think about Peter Folan as a channel? For Americans, they cut to the chase right away. No way!
For example.
Or they would say, no, he's got really great qualities. In some other cultures, you had to listen for like 15 minutes. They were so kind and everything, all the very most positive quality. And then all of a sudden, one little thing.
Which was on that little.
You're right. That was the thing that said, oh, they don't think that person really can do the job.
So. It was interesting. So this was the second week of October. The election was on the 14th, so 10th through the 13th. We had these, and it was kind of contextualized within an atmosphere of retreat. Many of us were walking to the Curia twice a day, back and forth, because we had to go back and get our lunch, our pranzo. But those 4 days, we all stayed in the Curia, and the Blessed Sacrament was exposed on the altar, and we were encouraged to correct so we were praying and not eating well. But it was fascinating to compare that to what we knew what was going on in the States. And now this is comparing apples and oranges. but the campaigning was coming to a peak. And you know, just to reflect upon how we were doing things so differently. So if you're running for office, you put yourself out there, you get nominated, and then you're promoting yourself to get other people to promote your candidacy. Here's why a good candidate, and part of it is probably denigrating the opposition. And it's part of the system. I'm not saying that we're so much better for not having this was totally different. It was, first of all, grounded in the context of prayer, praying for the Spirit, begging the Spirit to lead us to the person God was wanting to lead the society. Nobody's campaigning. If you are campaigning, you get tossed out. But not only are you not campaigning for yourself, but you're not campaigning for others. And one of the things about the Murmurations that was interesting was you were only to answer the question that was asked. So Peter mentioned the notion of charity. This is already done in charity. You want to speak honestly, truthfully too. But you were only supposed to answer the question that was asked to you. And so part of the skill was, and we got a little bit of training beforehand as we were coming into the meetings, was learning to ask the right questions. But to reflect upon how the, and then the hour Jim mentioned, we had Mass of the Holy Spirit at the Church of the Holy Spirit, right across the street. We came back into the aula, and rather than start the election, we had a brief exhortation, and then an hour of silence where we were praying. So just the different way of going about electing our leader was extraordinarily different than the process here.
I'm wondering if it would be helpful. We have a video that the general congregation itself produced, or the communications folks there. If you haven't seen this website yet, www.gc36.org, it's a great, great website. But I'm wondering, maybe we could watch this, and then just even two questions to guide you guys as we're watching, because you've given such a great description of it. One, does art imitate life? Because as far as I know, this was shot before Murmuratio began at this general congregation. When you see this, and compare it to your experience, is it matching up? And even, is the experience of Murmuratio something that simply preceded the election of the general, and then it was over, or something like that present throughout the next weeks of the congregation? So, we roll the video tape.
Murmuratio, it's a Latin word to say just chatting.
Literally whispers, murmurings.
It's a time for prayer, a time for thinking, time for talking, and with that human knowledge and that spiritual knowledge, in a sense, you've got a good idea of where we are going.
There is a time, a specific time inside of the general congregation, which we talk one-to-one, so not in groups, about people. We try to do that in kind of a spiritual environment for trying to choose the right person as a general of the Society of Jesus.
It comes directly to us from Ignatius, who was convinced that God talks to us through spiritual motions that we experience of consolation, of desolation.
There's a process of praying and listening for the voice of the Spirit that goes into it.
And I think that Spirit is very, very active amidst us, around us, and with us. And I think Murmuratio works not because of us, because we are open to the Spirit.
Because we are Jesuits from so many different parts of the world, and gathering for a very important event of electing a new general, it just seems appropriate that we spend time together trying to get comfortable with one another, trying to find out about one another, trying to ask questions, clarify doubts, seek information.
It's going to be another strange kind of experience of friendship.
It's that communal spirit that I'm really excited about.
So, did art imitate life in your experiences? And is this something that pushed on beyond the day of October 14th when you elected the general? Something that maybe informed even your way of proceeding?
Don't jump in all at once here.
I think that those descriptions certainly resonates with my experience. Maybe part of it was to educate yourself. We certainly know people from this context, and some of us who I was at the Procurators Congregation in Nairobi in 2012, so I knew a fair number of people who were there. I'd met them already, but you want to learn what other people are thinking and learn about other candidates. So I found that to be a good description. And it is amazing. You're having an important conversation, a number of important conversations with people you've just met a week ago. But one of the things about the society that I've always loved is because we have these common experiences in our formation and making the exercises, there's a language we speak, there's a commonality and an acquaintance that is easy to just take off and get into a deeper conversation. In terms of things going forward, I think Joe and I had a lot of murmuraciones. We live pretty close to one another. We walk back and forth quite a bit. I think we, with some others, had quite a few murmuraciones. Yeah, you do. It becomes part of, and it wasn't just for electing the general, but as we move towards the documents and what was going on there.
You know, the Jesuits once a year with the provincial has what's known as an account of conscience. And the account of conscience means that we tell the provincial where we are, and we're very honest about what's going on in our lives and in our hearts. And in many respects, as we did these memoratios, was having accounts of conscience with different people about other people. And you knew that it was from their lens. It was only from their point of view that they could speak about someone. And then you come to some idea about that person. And then when you went to see a person who you thought might be general, you'd have a different kind of conversation. You might ask, like, how's their health? Because you wanted to see they are the kind that they could sustain the job. And what was their vision of the society? And I would say with the conversations that we had, it's confession. And I will go to my death with some of the things I heard and learned. And I think other delegates feel the same way. So it really is a sacred moment and a sacred moment. These are things. So it is a little gossipy in the sense of people tell you stories of their experiences, positive and negative, with different people, or things that they have heard about someone. And you have to discern and say, what's the fake news and what's the real?
Do you want to add anything before we ask about why Father Arturo won? What was it about him that made him be chosen? And also, you mentioned before the significance of his being the first Latin American, and of course he's from Venezuela, but is that significant? Why did he prevail?
Well, he's definitely, I mean, I think just the 215 people present, you just got a sense of the holiness of the room. And, you know, Arturo Sosa, like Father Nicolas, the previous general, and like Pope Francis, I'm convinced none of them won. But they're all humble and really believe that they're going to follow what God asked them. And I think that it was very clear to, again, I think people, when we did a whole examination of the world we live in terms of the three calls, and you know, obviously there's real great concern about refugees and displaced peoples and migrants, and so we know what's out there in terms of the peripheries where the church needs to be, and I think Arturo was a provincial, he's a political scientist, he's a man of prayer, he's very concerned, as the Holy Father is, with these concerns that the world is facing today. And his name just kept getting elevated, and by the fourth day, we kind of knew he was a serious candidate.
Yeah, I think one of the things we left unstated, but as part of the process too, we looked at the state of the Society of Jesus. That was it was a document produced the De Statu. And in some of our preliminary conversations before the Murmurationis, and the Murmurationis would continue this, was the question, well, what are we looking for in the general? What are the characteristics we're looking for? What was interesting to me was I mistakenly thought geography might be an issue. But from talking to people of different parts of the world, that was not the case at all. It was really looking for the best. So there was no sense that we need to get somebody. So this wasn't somebody chosen to match Pope Francis. So that was a surprise to me. That played no role. Something that I think was important was we recognized that we're at a unique moment in the history of the society, history of the church, where you have Pope Francis, who is a Jesuit, who has set forth a course in which, in some respects, I think we as Jesuits have to humbly say, he's ahead of us in terms of his vision for the church, what ministry is, to whom we should be ministering, how we should be ministering. I think the Jesuits, we like to think we're ahead of the game, but in this case, I think he's ahead of us. So one of the issues, I think, for me and for many of us was to have a general who fully bought into that vision and the documents, you know, Laudato Si, Joy of the Gospel, the various synod documents. That was important. Now, another question that came up, and of course this is pertains to the future and therefore we can't predict it, but what's going to happen after Francis and the next pope? And to me, and that went in a couple of different directions. There was a sense in which, well, there might be a backlash, or there might be continuation. To me, that wasn't the issue. I think the issue for many of us was, regardless of who the next pope is, Francis has set us on a course. And I think, Father, I mean, there were many who would be good to take that vision and bring to the society, or at least make it explicit in terms of our own reflection. But I think Father Sosa in particular fit that bill, if I might put it that way.
I wonder if there's anything you could share about Father Sosa. That, I mean, I was reading a little bit about him before, born 1948, Venezuela, degree in political science. What were your impressions of him as a person? His sense of humor, his way of proceeding, his style of governance, just what he'd be like to bump into outside the aula. That aula is the room where the meetings of the general congregation were held. What sort of a person is he?
Well, he and his mom shared the same birthday.
There we go. I did not know that.
And we had a gathering one night, and they Skyped his mom so that she could speak with him, and they shared the same birthday. The general congregation is higher than the general that we elect. Until the general congregation disperses and votes that it's over. So he really is, in a way, a listener. And he was a great listener. And he then reflected back on occasion some of the things that he had heard and that were of concern. And so he did set out that. He's decisive. He already started appointing provincials while we were there. So there was a sense of decisiveness that we got to see his father.
It was interesting, the night before the congregation started our first session in the aula, we had a mass at the Church of the Jesuit. This is where the Dominican, head of Dominicans preach. On our faculty, we have two Venezuelan theologians, they're lay theologians, and one of them gave me, he said, I want to say hello to two people. And one of them was this guy named Arturo Sosa, whom I had met before. Well, as it turns out, as we were waiting for the mass to start and getting vested, I was right next to him. I said, oh, I introduced myself, and I said, I have a hello to you. And he was kind of surprised that he sat three people away from me because we sit in alphabetical order in the aula. And one thing that struck me was he knew a lot of people, and a lot of people liked him, because rarely did somebody walk by him without making some you know, exchange. And then good sense of humor, has got a great smile, very warm smile. My sense, and I would reiterate what Joe said, I was impressed by how well he listened. They listened very well, had a good finger on the pulse of what was going on in the aula. But he's got a, I think he's going to be an Agamemnon in a sense. I think he's going to be a reader of men. he showed, I thought, a sense of decisiveness, which I think is also what we were looking for.
Let me ask you, Father Jinnah, before we move on. But we're all in a Jesuit parish here, and he's the Father General. And we know what the Pope does. You know, we just got the year of mercy and talked about divorce, remarried Catholics, and more compassion on a whole lot of levels. So is he going to do something that's going to change the way, I know he's not going to change the rules of the church, obviously, but change the way the Jesuit parishes operate? Or are we, that our parishioners, going to see something different from Father Arturo or not?
I think what we're going to see, and he's already articulating, is his vision. Not that Father Nicholas did not have vision, but Tom was, you were talking about how his vision really does align itself quite well with Pope Francis. And one of the criticisms that we talked about the congregations, we have great documents from other congregations, but we don't have really strategic plans. So it was interesting, one of the four words he mentioned was planning. I think for a place like Boston Public, or St. Ignatius Parish, if we're saying with Pope Francis that we have a real concern for displaced peoples around the world, and we have to learn to consume and produce in a way that's very different than the current model, which leaves many people out on the streets, how do all of our institutions, whether they're a parish or be it Boston College, align themselves to those values and work for the justice of all peoples? So I think it's going to be providing vision and challenging any Jesuit-sponsored work to be about promoting the justice of all people. So I think we're going to move, hopefully, beyond beautiful documents to seeing much more action and institutions as means to act on these global issues of justice.
I think concretely what we're going to see is an emphasis and a push for communal apostolic discernment. The Pope asked us to teach the church about Ignatian discernment and how to do that communally. And during the congregation, at our best moments, and even Jesuits have trouble with this, but only at our best moments were we able to do the spiritual conversation, listening really carefully in small groups, coming back together, trying to hone what it is that the Spirit is telling us. Because our tendency is debate, and debate is not discernment. And so that is the important piece to hold on to. And so as Jesuits, we love to debate and argue. And so sometimes we got into that. And we have to step back and go back to communal apostolic discernment, spiritual listening, making sure that we're respecting one another's point of view and seeing from that where the Spirit is taking us. And many times I have my mind and heart change during the congregation as a result of the spiritual conversation and the discernment rather than the debate. The debate.
You're just boring.
More.
And as you were just saying, Joe, Jim, and Tom, you were saying earlier, speaking about the Holy Father, Father General, obviously spoke about that in the video, October 24th, that's the day that the Holy Father comes to the hour. And I thought maybe we could talk about that for a little bit. We have a video of this, too. Some of you BC people might recognize right at the start of the video, the longtime dean of the Lynch School, Joe O'Keefe, who also presides a lot at St. Ignatius. I love, you can see his picture there, right when the Pope walks into the hour. I love his expression of joy.
Today, Monday, October 24th, at the invitation of the Jesuit Curia in Rome, Pope Francis joined the Jesuits of the 36th General Congregation for a morning of prayer and conversation. He was greeted by the new Jesuit leader, Father General Arturo Sosa, and the superior of the Jesuit Curia, Father Joaquin Barrero. He made his way upstairs to the aula, the large hall where the Jesuits had been working all these weeks, and was greeted with thunderous applause and cheerful admiration. Once the room was settled and the Jesuits took their place, the musicians played instrumental music to set the tone for the special morning prayer service. Hymns were sung, and intentions in various languages were voiced for Pope Francis and the Church. At the conclusion of their morning praise, all the men recited the Our Father and sang together Ad Maiorem Dei Gloria. In much beloved content, speaking in Spanish, gave his address to the faithful Jesuits. At the conclusion of his speech, the Holy Father joined Father General and the Jesuit delegates for a large group photo, a photo that will historically capture this special day when the first Jesuit Pope comes to a Jesuit General congregation.
Personally, but also it strikes me that this wasn't kind of pause work on October 23rd and then resume again on October 25th. We just basically had a day off. The Pope visited. That was great. But did he open up new lines of thought or conversation, amplifying whisper, what may have been whispers of the Holy Spirit? What was the newness that came out of this visit?
Let me start with Joe was talking about apostolic discernment. One of the things we were working on, reflecting on the previous week was decrees, whether we want, need a decree, and talking about life and mission, and we're in language groups and small groups, and there was a certain sense, I can say this, I think, that we were getting closer to October 24th, and we were not at loggerheads, but struggling. And there was a sense of, well, let's just wait for Francis to tell us what to do. That's a bit of a caricature, but that was, I think, part of the thinking. And so those who wanted Francis to tell us what to do were disappointed because he didn't give us, he basically reminded us that that was our task. But he also gave us some salutary pointers as to what would help us get there. So I was struck by his great respect for, because he'd been part of these congregations, allowing the Spirit to work within us, let the congregation do what the congregation should be doing. That was one impression. I was struck, I keep talking about going back to the basics. He had three main points that he led us through, and they're so fundamental but so essential. So the first thing was he said we need to pray for the grace of consolation, and thank God for that grace. That is fundamental to who we are. I work in the Pauline literature, so I tend to translate things that in those ways. But I think what he was basically calling us to was be in such a way, pray in such a way that your relationship with Christ allows you to experience those fundamental graces of his mercy and love that brings about that sense of joy and peace that only the Spirit can give. Because one can only be a minister of the joy of the gospel if one has that deep down in one's core. I was really struck by just that fundamental, just reminding us of going back to the exercises in that way. And then secondly, reminding us that he focused on the cross of Christ in a sense, I think it was a minimally twofold sense. One was this is how God's love was revealed most dramatically, but also reminding us of how Christ is present today in a very special way among those who are suffering, and that we need to be attentive and open our hearts to Christ's presence in that way. And then thirdly, reminding us that this is where we started talking about discernment, and this is who we are, the core of our being as Jesuits. This is a gift that we have that we're to share with others, and that we do so not just as individuals, we're to do it communally, and that's a big challenge, and we'll talk a little bit more about that, working as an individualism that we can be susceptible to, but also that we do so as part of the church, that we don't operate alongside of or apart from the church, we do this within the context, in the church and for the church.
I think too, that's where I think a lot of people, those who have the Francis pushback, he kept emphasizing, not so much in the address, but in the questions and answers, he said, he really believes that a lot of seminary training is done in fear. And he said, fear brings rigidity. And why are people afraid of prayer and discernment? Why do people want things so clearly defined? That's not how the Spirit works. So I was moved by that. And also his openness. The question and answers, he said basically you can answer any question. And he was, I thought, very honest. And one delegate asked him at one point, well, at the end of the day, tell us about your prayer. And he said, you know, I'm often a pessimistic person. Which is interesting, because he talks so much often about joy. So maybe he's preaching to himself, which I think we all do. He said, and sometimes at the end of the day, the evil spirit has gotten a hold of me, and I see things, you know, half empty rather than half full, and I have to spend the day praying for forgiveness. So not only is he calling all of us to be people of discernment, but he himself does that day in and day out.
And I loved one of his asides. He said, have a sense of humor. So that was, as he was talking about joy, the part of joy is having a sense of humor.
I think just to kind of orient us in terms of time for what we're going to do tonight, maybe we could take maybe 10 more minutes in our conversation, then open it up to about 20, 25 minutes of Q&A from everyone who's assembled here. But the bulk, of course, of time of the congregation is spent in the ad negotia phase. And so producing decrees and things like that. And so a lot of different ways we could go here, whether you want to talk about the work of that time with respect to those four words that Father General used, how that worked its way through those weeks, what it was like having people from vastly different cultures and ministerial and apostolic experiences coming together to try to say something to the universal society, anything that you noted there. One of the words that he mentioned was reconciliation, and just to think about you guys being there in the midst of the election in the United States, which you mentioned earlier. Just today, I'm sure some of you saw that Time magazine named Donald Trump the Person of the Year, and on the cover, I think, of the magazine, it said President of the Divided States of America. Somebody calls out for reconciliation, something you address. So anything that you want to pick up from in those weeks?
I think groups always start out with some kind of bifurcation. And in fact, you expect that in group dynamics. In fact, if it sounds like it's too homogenous, you're not listening carefully enough, or somebody's not speaking, but people often hold other points of view, and they're oftentimes contrary. That was true of us as well as I looked at the way the congregation moved. However, so to give you an example, we did this life and mission document. It went through 7 drafts with 7 different titles. And so it kept going back and forth, and you know, it's too long. Oh, now it's not long enough. And so you would hear this kind of back and forth about the documents. And so what you had to learn, and I think the groups do learn this, is consensus. It's not so much compromise, it's consensus. This is not what I would choose, but I can live with it because the Spirit is moving in that direction. And that's really key to communal apostolic discernment. And we had to do that time and time again with the different documents. And I think that was a very graced experience for people as we coalesced around, yes, we can live with this document. Is it perfect? No. And what do you know? I keep reminding people that Americans will probably be disappointed with the documents because they're speaking to a worldwide society. And some of the things that we already do, well, why are they telling us this? Like, we already collaborate. Look at Boston College. You know, there's a handful of Jesuits compared to how many collaborators we have. But why? So why are these documents talking about that? Well, it's because in some other places, they're not there yet. And what the growing edge, I think, for us is the word we use in the document called networking, which means that we have to come out of our little shells and see how we're going to help one another across all the Jesuit universities, all the Jesuit parishes, working together, the Jesuit retreat houses. How do we work together? How do we network to raise all the boats?
You might wonder why the topics were chosen, and part of the process of the General Congregation is the individual provinces, but also individual Jesuits could send what are called postulata, which are to raise concerns or things that they would like taken up by the General and the Congregation. And I don't know how many postulata there were submitted. There were dozens upon dozens. And there was a coordinating committee that sifted through that, or a postulata committee that sifted through those. And before, a year before we met, so this was October of 15, they'd already kind of come upon themes that they thought captured a lot of what was brought up in these postulata. So the question of what Jesuit life and mission, community life and mission, became a leitmotif. They gathered a lot of these, as well as governance for mission. So those will be the two documents that have a little bit of length to them. But I think one of the tensions many of us felt was, I think we've gotten into this pattern following General Congregation 31, but there's an expectation that a congregation is going to produce a number of documents and inspiring documents, and there's been some wonderful ones. Jim mentioned we've got this whole, you've seen the volume of decrees from GC 31 through 35, the book's about that thick. And the question, one question was, do we need more decrees? And it was interesting to hear the different expectations, because I think for some of the delegates, of course we do, we have to do this, but that's actually a fairly recent development. So this was also part of the give and take and listening to one another. And I do think we came out. I must admit that this was when Joe and I were doing a lot of preparation. The committee of 215 can be a tough committee. And the back and forth on this, but I do think we ended up with things that will definitely be worth our reading and reflecting and praying over.
I think too, so a lot of it was just directed more to us as Jesuits, and someone was saying, I don't find these very challenging, and I said to this person at the congregation, I said, taking this to the United States, to Jesuit communities here, the United States will be very challenging. It talks about the importance of really living in communities where we are truly friends in the Lord, that we have spiritual conversation as a normal part of our living together, and that all Jesuit communities have proximity to the poor. So both like Ignatius and the First Companions, to be learned, but with the poor. They always were, as they studied in Paris or wherever, they were always out on the streets doing works of mercy. So going back to our roots, it's calling all Jesuit communities to live this way. I think that's going to be challenging.
personally.
Okay, you avoided the political question that Peter asked about being over at the congregation when Donald Trump was elected president. And I'm dying to know, you're an international community there of religious priests are talking about social justice and refugees and the marginalized and dispossessed. What kind of reaction did you get from your fellow Jesuits that weren't from the United States about the crazy Americans and their election?
Irish wake, have you ever been to one? Really, condolences.
Really?
Outpouring condolences.
And questions and misunderstandings.
How could this happen?
How could this happen?
I need more talks on the Electoral College. Could not understand it. How could somebody get the majority and lose? So this was a chance for education too, because even leading up to the election, people were saying from different parts of the world, "You're not serious about it. They're not serious. He can't become president, do you think?" So there was concern, I have to say, across the board. I didn't hear a single delegate not express concern, both before and fear after the election.
Hey, as a reminder of, it wasn't just the Americans who were interested in the outcome of that election, at that congregation, everyone was calling. As a matter of fact, the week before, I can think of at least a half dozen times where somebody would come up to me and said, "You don't think Donald Trump can win the election?" And maybe I was just reading the New York Times and I was seeing that 88%, 99%. And you know, and I was saying, this is our Brexit, and I didn't think Britain would vote as it did. I said, I think we're gonna come to the edge of the cliff and people are gonna take a deep breath. And so it was pretty amazing and surprising, but what struck me was people were following it very closely, but also what they were reading was perhaps more accurate than what I was reading, what could happen. It was really striking to me. Very striking. Coming from the Midwest, I had to explain a little bit how people think out there. I find myself defending a little bit. I mean, because the some caricatures of the voting, but and also explain the Electoral College, that is a system that is hard for people to understand.
We've reached a point where we have about 25 minutes left for our time together, so I'm wondering if we could go with some questions. It seems like the room is small enough that we could probably do without a microphone here, but if you have a question, you could just raise your hand and stand, and ideally the questions would be brief, succinct. Ben, and then please second. Please, Ben.
Very succinct, having been in the belly of the beast and emerged, and now safe on dry land, what concerns and hopes do you bring back from your experience? Concerns and hopes.
I think one always has to be careful that, you know, as an exegete, we try not to eisegete, which is to read into things. But I think that Father General Sosa and his emphasis on planning and on the importance of strategic plan, timelines, assessment. I think he was sending signals. We all agreed the society can't do everything. And this isn't a woe is us that we're not as big as we used to be. Just being realistic. And I think he was sending signals that part of this is going to be the challenge to making some tough decisions. Maybe moving from some things in the past and going forward, which I actually take as a hopeful thing, because it's very real, and I think so. I might be projecting some of my hopes onto him on that, but I think he was really giving us frameworks for being real in our discernment and reminding ourselves we're not the savior.
My biggest personal concern and hope is, my hope is communal apostolic discernment, and my concern is communal apostolic discernment. that we won't have the wherewithal to put it into practice. It takes a stance of indifference, and it takes a freedom, and it relies on God's grace, and it's a beautiful thing, but you have to give yourself to the process. We kept using a word in Spanish, proceso. That became a kind of controversial word. People didn't really understand it, but to me it was a perfect word. We have to engage in this process and move forward if we're going to grow into the deep. And so it's a hope and a concern.
I think a concern of mine would be, I think the vision will be there, but the implementation has been problematic. So the concern is, how do we reallocate resources? And what I'm talking about there is both personnel and money to meet some of these needs worldwide. I think many of our apostolates, at least here in this country, tend to be silos. And even though Nicolas challenged us at Mexico City, the higher ed at least, to do much more networking in a global way, we're taking baby steps, but that's going to take reallocation of resources.
Please.
This is really mundane question, but can you just explain how you communicated with 215 and the languages? Going through it, I thought, how would this all work?
There were four languages that were permitted in the aula: English, Spanish, French, and Italian. And there were translators, so we had people translating the whole time.
And then when we had discussions in the aula, there was somebody always moderating the session, and so one would only speak when one was acknowledged. And the way you put yourself in a position to be acknowledged was to hit this little key on the tablet called intervention.
Mind playing Jeopardy.
And we were told at a certain point when you could touch the. And what was striking was, this might not come as a surprise to you, is that then it was projected on screens, the order that people got in. Well, the technology sometimes was a little iffy, but the same people would appear.
It was an extroverted world, and it killed us introverts.
And the extroverts, and I would say for much of it, the Americans tended to not intervene so much because we were ready to move on with things. But
so then in small groups, which was really beautiful, was if someone didn't would prefer, let's say, to speak in Spanish, Tom, Jim, someone in the group would volunteer to translate. And it was beautiful because you got to hear them speak in their language. I prefer that better than simultaneous translation, actually, because you hear it and you see their expression and their passion, and then you get the translation. So the small groups, and I think everyone really, the sense was, the small groups, the mixed small groups of languages was really charming.
When would we expect to see publication of the documents?
January. 17. Yeah.
That's what we've been told.
Please.
How much emphasis was put on the collaboration with lay people? You have an extraordinary instrument, which are the spiritual exercises that you get through the Christian life communities. How much of the emphasis was put on the collaboration with lay people to participate in all the other fields that you were high pointing, like refugees and so forth? The mean term of a refugee in a refugee camp is about 18 years. So there are families there, and the Pope puts a very strong emphasis on strengthening families, and CLC, or Christian Life Communities, are a wonderful instrument of yours.
Yeah, I would say by the associates, his opening homily, that was one of the key themes, and making very clear that collaboration isn't necessary evil because we don't have enough Jesuits. It's actually a great thing because there's people who bring talents and abilities and skills that we don't have. So that's a big part of what I took from Father Sosa, that he's really saying this is the world that we're living in, and this is a wonderful thing. This is how God is calling us. This is what it means to be Jesuits in the world today. So that was one thing he said. I think another thing that we were challenged by him, and it's going to appear in one of our documents, and this is a hard thing, is it's one thing to work alongside one another. I think for many of us Jesuits, the challenge can be, do we share co-responsibility? And that's, you'll certainly see that language come out of one of the documents. And in other words, if you're going to bring people on board, it's not necessarily a two-tier operation, which is not to in any way blur the distinction between Jesuits and lay. We each have our own vocations, but the way we actually work together, discern together. So part of this apostolic discernment, communal apostolic discernment, involves Jesuit communities, but also within particular postulates, those who are involved. So at St. Ignatius, BC, it's not just the Jesuits who are getting together. So it's both. It's I think very inviting. It's also a great challenge. It's calling all of us to take our prayer lives very seriously.
Notation 819 was really good.
19th annotation with the exercises you mean of the spiritual exercises in everyday life,
sure,
which is something that's a hallmark both at St. Ignatius and of course at the Center for Ignatian Spirituality here on campus.
This might sound unpolitic about the collaboration, but what strikes me is we have a lot of collaboration with lay people. If you go to our conference in Washington, there are lay people in administrative positions side by side with Jesuits. You go into our province offices, we have lay people in very administrative positions with Jesuits. You go to the General Curia in Rome, there's only Jesuits. So it's still a very male-dominated place. So will we see in the next years under Arturo Sosa? That's a hope, and a concern is whether we'll see different secretariats under or, you know, in collaboration more with lay people. And I think that would be an interesting move in Rome.
Yes, I have two questions. One, at the beginning you spoke about the Jesuits as being that intellectual presence. I want to know, how are you defining that word, intellectual?
It's one thing to do acts of mercy and to work with the poor. It's another thing to ask, why are they poor? And to start advocating for them and to be their voice. And I think that's the intellectual dimension. How do you get to, what are the structures, what are the underlying causes that becomes the intellectual field in which you then do the analysis? So you have a number of religious bodies who work, concentrate on the poor and being with them and rubbing elbows with them, like the beautiful work of the Missionaries of Charity. Wonderful. However, they don't do any analysis of that. And so that's the call to have not only Jesuits, but all our collaborators, all our institutions engaged in that.
So changing the system.
System.
The other one is, did the topic of women of the church come up at all? Women's role in the church.
It did, and first of all, that came up obviously, as you know, in just the previous congregation. It was interesting, in the one document on mission and life, I believe, it's in terms of those who are excluded, so refugees, migrants, and women are mentioned, so recognition that we're still not in terms of true collaboration in terms of gender.
Please, Joe.
Looking back on the whole experience, is it possible to say that the leadership energy in this area or that area came from one group or another, you know, the Mexican Jesuits or the Albanian Jesuits or something, you know, really provided a lot of the energy in this area?
No, I would say, Joe, that the people that I think, the delegates that struggled the most were delegates coming from parts of the world in the spirit that they're insular. They don't have much of global experience. So monolingual delegates, there were a number of people, let's say India, for instance, a huge number of delegates from India. I think very few of them, I mean, they spoke their dialects, obviously, in English, but they didn't speak other languages, and many of them did not have a global experience of the society. So I think the ones that were more kind of bilingual, or they were able to network in a way that I thought was more vibrant than certain other groups. So the Indians were the largest in number, but I don't think that just the sheer numbers gave them more influence. Please.
The thing about his prayer being pessimistic in the evenings, it gives me the sense of something I felt when we were just in Rome for 11 days among Jesuits at the Greg, that Pope Francis is embarking on a new turn, and the possibility of that turn carrying on is rather fragile. And so I was wondering if those deliberations that led to your documents and so forth had to do with supporting Francis in the time that he still is the Pope, so that I'm sure in your consideration of the next general, the idea of who would be a good person to carry on after Francis would be a pretty big thing. And how do we support the thrust that he started? Was that actually a topic or?
Oh, definitely. I tried to allude to that a little bit earlier. That was a concern for many of us. And again, I'm referring to documents you haven't seen, but take a look at when the documents come out, you'll see several references to Francis and his writings, particularly Laudato Si. So in answer to the intellectual question, one of the bullet points is to look long and hard at structural issues, or what is it that causes these inequalities in all aspects of life. And it basically says the things that Pope Francis pointed to in Laudato Si. So definitely, answer your question, yes, that was a concern.
I would like to know, do you as Jesuits, in trying to live out your charism, do you adhere strictly to a congregation, a societal charism, or do you look upon the charism of, let's say, St. Ignatius Church or Boston College, the students, the Faber community, that international group, or do you look at it generally?
The ideal is to do both. That can be challenging. I mean, it's easier, I think, for us at the STM in Faber because we're so international. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's one of the blessings that we have. And one of the things where, when you join the Society of Jesus, you enter through a province, but essentially you join the Society of Jesus. Now, we can all kind of fall into our parochial and provincial ways of being. But one of the things that we discussed, for instance, we're asking the general to set forth some clear apostolic priorities that we've had some in the past. So for instance, China is an apostolic priority, Africa. And one way of looking at that, or dealing with. That is, okay, we, our province trains a man, we're gonna send him to China. Well, that's, that, I mean, that's a way of doing that, but I think what we're trying to do is be in such a way that, man, not all of us can go to China, but to, within our local contexts, be as responsive to the universality of the society and needs as we can be. So now that's a tough balance to achieve, but ideally that's, we do both. But you also, you can't just live out, I mean, we're all, we live in a certain place and time. That's where we're doing our work in ministry, and then it has to respond to local context as well.
What made me ask that question was the previous speaker who posed a question about Pope Francis's evening prayer, mm-hmm. and the way he described that, the tone of it, and that being almost like a contradiction, as someone mentioned earlier, between his joy and what he really expresses so vividly, and it's very attractive and very much needed in our world. And so I think he's very realistic and being very authentic in sharing that. At the same time, I think he has a strong charism for joy and how important that is in the whole arena of evangelization and everything that we try to live. And also taking his age into account, and the question that was asked earlier about whether you as Jesuits see any, well, maybe whether you have any hope to be some sustaining energy in helping that joy to continue to live, even if Francis is no more.
You know, I tell people all the time that as the rector of a formation with Theology here, 80 guys, Pope Francis has made my job so much easier. I just quote him all the time. And I think you're right. I mean, I don't think he says that he's a pessimistic, and he can be pessimistic at times, but he is a man of deep prayer, and that's why he talks about joy and mercy all the time. I love that he said to us, you know, people talk about acts of mercy, but we need to look at mercy as a way of life. It's not an act, it's a way of living life. And I do think he lives that. And we definitely felt and talked about all the time in the congregation, this is an opportune time, not only for the church with Pope Francis, but also for us as Jesuits. We haven't had this moment.
Just to say something about his prayer, you know, in the Jesuit tradition has the idea of agere contra, to act against whatever tendency you have. So of course, you know, a life of prayer when you're pessimistic, I understand it myself because I am often see the glass as half empty. And one time I was on retreat and say, I have to get over this, seeing the glass as half empty. And the answer to my prayer was, but the glass is always at a half. Just get comfortable with it. So it was a sense of agere contra and then coming to something else. So I think, so Pope Francis was being so human in that and saying, you know, that's part of the spiritual exercise, the daily spiritual exercise that we have to do.
We have time for one more question, please.
So I'm curious about how the 215 got there, like taking a step back almost. So there's no lobbying for the position and trying to be the superior general, and really trying to listen to the spirit and have that elevate and understanding that fully. But I'm curious of how the folks got in the room, because it's rare that the superior general would not be in the room. And so there is this idea of the provinces are still sending folks that they still kind of would back up and could see possibly being chosen. So I guess talking a little bit more about how you all got there, it seemed as though some of you may not know exactly how or why, but someone's keeping an eye on the folks getting into the room, because likely the man will surface from being there.
Well, concretely, it's so we go to these province congregations, and let's say there's 40 people at it. Then they say, okay, now we need to elect someone to send to Rome. And you write a name on a piece of paper, it's very old-fashioned, and then they just start putting names on the chalkboard. And usually the person elected is not going to be elected. You have to have a majority, not elected on the first vote. But, you know, I'm sure we all have the experience. When you start seeing your name mentioned a few more times, you're sitting there thinking, oh no. And so that's how it's a very human process, and the spirit, maybe works. I don't know. I hope it works.
I keep mentioning Joe. Joe and I walked back quite a bit, and we had some conversations about there's certain skills, I think, traits that would be good for a delegate to have that we might not have known about before we were there, and
might not have had.
The province congregation been more informed too, just in terms of. For instance, you need some people who can write. You need people who can do documents. I'll speak for myself. I was joking with people before I left. I said I was told to get a round trip ticket. In other words, it was clear. But your question is a good one, because somebody in that room is going to be the general.
And I told people. They asked me, well, could you be general at the congregation? I said, the one thing I would be certain of is that if I became general, the Holy Spirit went on vacation. You know, there's a certain quality that you're looking for, a certain type of experience that a person has in order to lead such a diverse group of people. And so you hope that the Holy Spirit has designed it in such a way that enough people are in the room for us to deliberate about. And there was, for us to really say. And it surfaced fairly quickly, because you have to do your homework. You have to go through the bios of all these people that you don't know, 215 people. And you sit there and you take notes and you see what their ages are, what their background was, what they bring to the table. And so that gives you the list, so that you can go and say, well, do you know so-and-so? And start asking the questions in the memoratio. You want to have that all there. So it's a lot of work. This was not a vacation.
Well, we certainly come to the port of the evening for some thanks, and so obviously, thanks first of all to you guys, both for you. For your time and your service over in Rome, and for being with us tonight. I think I echo what everybody else says, that this was terrific.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for being so candid with us and open with us. Thanks to Tomeu and to Cindy for organizing all this tonight. Thank you. And I've always been jealous of Jim Browdy.
Oh yeah.
But I'm even more jealous now that I've had an hour and a half to do what he gets to do every day for hours. So thank you so much. Thank you. Well, thanks everyone. Have a great evening. Good night.